Well, greetings to each of you. Happy third day of Christmas to us all, and greetings to those of you who are logging on the stream. We're blessed to be with you as well. Well, here we are. It's a special week, the week of Christmas, and we're resting, and at the same time, many of us ramping up for activities that begin tonight up at camp, and we're thankful that this day is what it needs to be. Here at Woodland, we are going to be celebrating our rest, if you want to say it that way, all the way to January the 6th. That's the next time that we'll have youth group. So that's when our programming for children and youth will begin, January the 6th. So no education hour today or next week for children and youth. Our adults, however, are going to meet this afternoon at 10:30 this morning, if you would like to stick around for that. So something going on for adults after this hour. For children and youth, we'll get going again on January the 6th. We'll also mention that the winter youth group retreat has moved to January the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th at Fort Wilderness. Michael will be sending out more email about that this week. And so if that's relevant for you, you can pay attention to your email and get in line with Michael there for that. And let's ask the Lord to bless our time this morning, and then we'll enjoy worshiping together. Father, thank you. Thank you for our Christmas celebration. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the grace that we need to ramp up tonight, if that's what we're doing up at camp, or to continue to rest throughout the weekend, if that's what you give us to do. And we thank you for this reflective time that helps us prepare for the year ahead. Thank you also for this morning as we open your word, as we sing, as we worship, as we focus our thoughts on you and are shaped by what we celebrate, which is you, Lord. Help us this morning. Would you be pleased in our worship today? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Brian. Again, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Woodland. Have a little bit of a living room feel here today. Glad you all are here. Glad to see you on the stream. Good morning. Pastor Brian is finishing our teaching segment on Jesus, our hope. And this subscript is Your Story in Christ. And we're going to look at the book of Matthew today. So since the Christmas story is not over in our teaching time, I also figured that the Christmas singing is not quite over yet either. So we have one final morning of Christmas songs together. So let's stand if you're able.
Born is a king of Israel. After Christmas, we can still be singing Christmas songs. There's nothing wrong with that. All right. This morning, for our missionary emphasis, we've got Jana Forseth out in Poland, and she's got a few things she'd like us to be praying about. First, she'd like us to know that the restrictions there are still pretty tight. Only 5 non-related people can be in homes at this point, and only 7 are allowed in church buildings in Poland. So you can imagine how weighty that is for those in ministry, those in God's people, having to go through that. And doctors and nurses, they're short on those healthcare workers, and so that's been pretty crazy. So Jan has been pretty creative about how to reach others with the gospel and teach others, and so she's been putting on puppet shows. And making videos to send over to children. And so just praying for creativity and how she can continue moving forward and trying to do ministry at a distance. She says that she would appreciate prayer to follow through on some projects she's got before her. Like most of us, I think when we have more going on, I feel like that gives us energy to keep moving through. But when we're frustrated and we're down and we feel like just there's a lot of barriers, then it's hard to get that motivation to move forward. So let's be praying for just energy for Jana to move forward and continue to follow through on some projects. Also, she's struggling with pain, both in her knee and her back. And so that's another barrier that she has. And so let's be praying for that. And then she's also asking for financial support. And so be praying for her financial support for Jana as well. And so we're going to pray for her in a minute here. But I'd like to turn us to 1 John chapter 4. I'm just going to read 2 verses from here. And this morning, Brian is going to be talking about our story in Christ. And these verses came to mind as I was considering what it means for God to bring us into his story. And it's really a story of love, God loving us. And so let me read a couple verses from 1 John chapter 4. This is verse 9 and 10. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Now that is a story that we can celebrate all year long, because God has loved us and brought us into his story by sending his Son. And so let's pray for Jana and prepare our hearts to listen to what God wants to teach us this morning. Lord, thank you. Thank you that you did not just leave us here, although we did deserve it. Lord, you loved us. You loved us to the point of sending your Son to die for us, to be the atoning sacrifice in our place, so that we once again could be your children, that we could be brought back into fellowship and into your family, Lord. And it's nothing that we have done. It's been completely a gift from you. Through your grace, we can be brought into the story of you, the story of life and light. And so, Lord, we are excited for what Brian has to teach us through Matthew chapter 2 and looking at the story of the Magi. And so, Lord, I just ask that you'd prepare our hearts this morning for the message and for worship, Lord. Although we're coming out of a holiday, some of us have maybe had a busy one, ones of us had maybe a slow one. We just ask that you would help us to focus on what really matters, and that is you, that is your story. And so, Lord, help us this morning. Lord, I also want to be praying for Jana this week. Lord, help us to remember her in our prayers. Lord, we think of the physical barriers that she's facing right now with the pain in her body. Lord, we ask that you'd that she would find relief, that you would heal her body. We also want to pray for her emotional barriers, that during this time of distance and lockdowns and not being able to be with those that she loves and cares about, Lord, we ask that you would encourage her through your word that will always be with us. Encourage her with your spirit that you promised us, and just raise up individuals who can reach out to her and just encourage her with notes, with phone calls, with emails, just to support her. We also pray for her financially, Lord. Working as a missionary, we're always living by faith, knowing that you will provide at the right time with what we need. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would give Jana the faith to lean on you and trust you during this time. And Lord, we ask that you would raise up individuals who will support her and be there financially for her so she can continue her service out there in Poland. So we thank you for Jana. We just ask that you would bless us this morning, that we would glorify you through this service. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Michael. Let's continue our time in song and worship together. If you can stand, please join me.
Shepherds, guardians, angels sing.
Anybody have dry fingers in the wintertime? The struggle is real.
We three kings of Orient are bearing gifts. We travel so far.
I love the direction you're going with this, Tim. This idea that we keep celebrating Christmas right after Christmas. Because I love all 12 days of Christmas. You know, our cultural celebration of Christmas pretty much ends when the shopping is over. And we get all these emails, you know, from everybody saying, last chance. I'm like, last chance for what? We don't really follow the historic church calendar here at Woodland. We kind of do because we celebrate Christmas and Easter, and we note some of the other church holidays. But it's a good thing to be aware of what Christians have celebrated and how Christians have celebrated around the world for 2,000 years. And actually, if you do follow the church calendar, you have the 12 days of Christmas, just like the song. And the 12th day of Christmas in many places is known as the Day of the Kings. And that would be January the 6th. And actually, when we were in Germany, this was a pretty big holiday. And it was the day that the Catholic kids, because we were in a Catholic area, they would dress up like wise men And about 7 in the morning, they would run around ringing, you know, bells and making noise and basically collecting money for the Catholic Church. And so one year we had some visitors, and they saw these cute kids running all over the street, and they were waving at them in the window and taking pictures and being tourists. And then the kids saw this, and here they all come running up the stairs. And I turned to our guests and I said, "How much money do you want to give to the Catholic Church now?" And the kids came and we took pictures and gave them some money, and we celebrated the Day of the Kings with the kids. So kind of fun, and I like to keep this celebration going. But what about these wise men? Speaking of the Day of the Kings, speaking of things that go on after Christmas, these guys are some of my favorites in the story. And I want to spend a little time today thinking about the wise men. And we'll turn this morning to Matthew chapter 2. This is the other Christmas passage, not Luke 2, where we spend so much time, but Matthew chapter 2. As we think about the wise men, and as we do that, we'll remember that we've been thinking this Christmas season, this Advent season, about Jesus, our hope. Jesus is our hope for hundreds and thousands of reasons. And maybe you've sat at your table or around your tree and you've talked about how Jesus is your hope and maybe listed out some of those reasons. And we can come back to this series because it's not going to end. Jesus continues to be our hope into this next year and forever. But this morning, we're going to think about our final reason Jesus is our hope, and it's because he includes us in his story, the grand story of redemption. And to think about that, we'll read about the wise men. Matthew chapter 2, I'm going to go from verse 1 to verse 12, and then we'll talk about what I like about this passage and note some of the stories that we find here in the passage. Matthew 2, 1 to 12. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. And this is the word of the Lord for us this morning. And Lord, we'll thank you for it and ask that you'd clear our minds here and help us to understand what you would teach us. Amen. Amen. There are actually three stories in this passage. Three little stories and then one big story. The first little story is the story of the Magi. And I like these guys, but as I come to this passage, I have to ask myself, how am I supposed to think about these guys. I mean, they just come from outside the area. They just sort of, they're not in Luke. They're only here in Matthew. They kind of appear. God has directed them. How am I to think about these guys? Well, in the original, they are called magi. That's actually a direct translation from the Greek. It's the word from which we get our word magicians. Interesting, huh? The ESV, my ESV, and probably your modern translation as well, calls them wise men. The song that we just sang called them kings, though they really weren't. The great song. They were kind of ancient quasi-scientists. They were astronomers. They were mathematicians. But mostly they were astrologers. I like to translate the word wizard. They were wizards. And I kind of imagine these guys wearing funny clothes, sitting in studies, piled high with manuscripts and like runes and like old maps and maybe some potions and stuff like that. You know, we, in our popular imagination, we kind of like wizards. We have, you know, we have works of imaginative literature like C.S. Lewis's Narnia or Tolkien's Lord of the Rings or J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter, which comes after my time. I'm not a fan as much, but I understand why younger people like Harry Potter. You got wizards in these things, and these are works of imaginative literature. My take on this is it's okay to enjoy these things, provided that we can separate fantasy from reality. And in our family, we read this stuff, and we talk about it, and we enjoy it. And really, the aim is always to love Jesus more, and certainly Lewis and Tolkien in particular help us do that. But the Bible is not fantasy. It's history and it's prophecy and it's epistolary literature. That means it's filled with letters. And it describes God's plan of redemption with Jesus at the center, Jesus who actually died and rose again, as sure as I'm standing here. And the Bible is hard on those, the Bible and its writers and God himself is hard on those who try to manipulate the spirit world. Those who are regarded like wizards, like sorcerers, like witches, I mean, they're not favored by Scripture. And yet, that's who these guys are. The Bible also says that they come from the East. That's where magi come from. The East is this description of Babylon and Persia, the countries that today make up Iraq and Iran. And we've met these guys before. They actually don't come from nowhere. We got a little time this morning. Turn back in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2. If you crack your Old Testament in the middle, you'll probably be in Psalms. Go to the right, and then you'll come to the major prophets of Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. We call them major prophets because they wrote bigger books than the minor prophets did. It's kind of a crazy way to designate them. But find those big prophets. Go to Daniel chapter 2. And when we get there, we're reading about a time in the 6th century B.C., so before Christ, long time before Christ, actually, when Israel is in captivity in Babylon, and they're ruled by a king, a pagan king, a Babylonian king named Nebuchadnezzar, and he's had a dream. What do you do when you have a dream and you're a pagan king? You call in your wizards. You call in your magicians. because you want to tap into what the spirit world is telling you about. And in verse 2 of Daniel 2, we read, "Then the king," that's Nebuchadnezzar, "commanded that the magicians, the enchanters, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans be summoned to tell the king his dreams. So they came in and they stood before the king." And then we have this long, awkward passage where he tells them the dream and they can't figure it out. "The Chaldeans answered the king," I'm down in verse 10 now. "The Chaldeans answered the king and said, 'There is not a man on earth who can meet the king's demands, for no great and powerful king has asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or Chaldean. The thing that the king asks is difficult, and no one can show it to the king except the gods, those dwelling, whose dwelling is not with flesh.'" They've got this right, haven't they? Notice that these magicians in Babylon are transcendent. They believe in a transcendent world where there really is a god or gods, or however they conceive of him, who is capable of revealing truth to us down here. That's transcendence. And they're right about this. Only problem is they can't tap into the truth because they're not aligned with the one true God. But somebody is. Remember who it is? It's Daniel. So they call in Daniel, and God reveals the dream to Daniel. Okay, back to Matthew 2. My take on the Magi is that they have the prophecies of Daniel. They come from the same area. And remember, Daniel was a big guy in Babylon. And even though 500-600 years seems like a long time to us, things didn't change as fast as they do today. This was the ancient world. And so they certainly would have remembered Babylon. They would have had his prophecies. And in fact, they probably had a copy of the Law of Moses. And if they did, they would have had the prophecy of Balaam. Remember him? Long time before Daniel, like 600 years before Daniel. Balaam was the pagan sorcerer who tried to curse Israel as they were coming into the promised land. In Numbers 24, we read, this is Balaam, "I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star shall come out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel." Interesting. Here are these magicians in the east. They probably know about Daniel. They have a copy of the law, and they've read about a star, Numbers 24, and now they see a star. There are all sorts of theories about what this star was. You can read them. There are dozens of theories and all sorts of mathematical calculations, and everybody believes they know what the star is all about. In fact, this week I was on my cell phone. I was just going to look at my calendar, and a news story popped up that this week, last night? I was asleep. I don't remember. Jupiter shall effect a conjunction with Saturn. And then the great question, is this the Christ star? No, it's not the Christ star. It's ridiculous. But they got me to read the story, which is all they wanted, I'm sure. The Christ star is not something that you can predict with mathematical precision. It's not like known constellations coming together. This Christ star is nothing other than the Shekinah glory of God. Think about Old Testament, Israel. How did they know where to go? I mean, they kind of knew where Palestine was. Surely they knew where that was. It wasn't called Palestine then. It was Canaan. Yeah, they knew that you go northeast and you get to Canaan, but when do you leave and how do you go together and what route should you take? Remember how God directed them? With a pillar of fire at night and a cloud in the daytime that was nothing other than his presence. That's what these wise men, the Magi, they were following the very presence of God, and like Abraham long before them, they obeyed God, and they went where he told them to go. Well, what do they want to do here in the passage? Remember that the Magi were astrologers. They were myth makers. They were storytellers. They would look at the night sky in particular, and they would see the constellations, and then they would imagine shapes in the sky. And as these constellations moved around during the course of the year, they would imagine these personalities in the sky interacting with each other, and they would create stories that explain the way that the world is, at least according to their imagination. We don't know very much about the mythologies of the Magi. We know more about Greco-Roman mythology, and we have constellations in the sky that we've named Cassiopeia, the Queen of the Night, the Gemini, the Hercules, Orion, Pegasus, Sagittarius, Taurus the Bull, Urza Major, the Big Bear, also known as the Big Dipper, and then Urza Minor, the Little Bear, the Little Dipper, and the Greeks and the Romans would look at the sky and they would imagine stories and myths that explain the way things were. They observed the stars. And in doing this, the ancients, the Magi, and others like them would attempt to penetrate the spirit world, and they would create these stories. And then one day, the Magi saw a star they couldn't account for. It hadn't been there before. And they didn't know what to do, and it sent them back to their manuscripts, their scrolls. And they took off. Why did they take off? They took off because they wanted more. That's what I take from this story. They wanted more. They weren't content to just stay with their mythologies and add this star to the stories that they were creating. They wanted to know more about this God who is revealing himself. And yet they weren't very likely when they turned up to worship Jesus. And this passage reminds me that there is special grace for people who don't yet know Christ, but who want him more. God will always show himself more to us when we want more of him. And so these unlikely figures entered into the great story of redemption, which is far bigger and truer and more beautiful than any story that they could make up on their own. That's the story of the Magi. That's the first story. We got another story in this passage, and that's the story of Herod. This is a lousy story. I don't like the story of Herod. Herod was the half-Jewish pretender to the throne of Israel. He's not a Davidic king, so he doesn't descend from David, so he shouldn't be sitting on the throne at all. He's against anything he understands God to be doing. He's a Roman puppet. He maintains power through political intrigue and making up his own story of reality. And then one day he hears that there's a new king, which is a big threat to him. Just put yourself in Herod's robes for a second here. The Magi turn up, verse 2 of chapter 2 in Matthew, and they ask, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." You're Herod. You think you're the king of Israel. And then these Magi turn up, these wizards, and they've got all these gifts, but they're not for you. And they start asking, "Where's the king that we can give these gifts to?" You could understand why the guy is upset. What's he do? He summons his experts. And everybody is troubled along with him, all Jerusalem with him, which shows us that the Magi are not sneaking around here. This was a very public thing when they turned up in Jerusalem with their camels and their entourage and all this stuff. Their purposes are not hidden. And Herod calls in the priests, the professors, the academics. The Magi wanted more, but they didn't have the technical data they needed to find the baby Jesus. These guys had the technical data they needed. They just didn't want more. And then Herod asked them, where am I going to find this Messiah, the Christ child? And they point him to Micah 5:2. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. The guys knew the answer. No problem. The problem is they didn't care. Did they go to Bethlehem? No, they didn't go. How far was it? 5 miles. Not even the distance between Westboro and Rib Lake, and yet they didn't even care enough to go see Jesus themselves. Then Herod gathers some clues, calls in the Magi. Now you're looking at a secret meeting, I think. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. So this is probably about 2 years after Jesus was born. For some reason, Mary and Joseph are still in Bethlehem. They're living, we're told, in a house. And so Herod has got to go back 2 years. And, oh yeah, the child appeared 2 years ago. He's been living here for 2 years. That's going to become important. And then he sends the Magi to Bethlehem. Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. Right. We know what Herod wants to do. And at this point, Herod slips from God's story. The Magi follow the star. Interesting, the star appears when God wants it to, right? It's not there always to follow all the time. It appears for the select people that God is leading, just like with Israel. The Magi follow the star. They find Jesus in Bethlehem in the house, and they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. And at this point, we hear very little more about Herod. He gets outsmarted. The Magi take off. They don't go back to see him. He tries to kill Jesus with the other babies in Jerusalem, a horrible story, or Bethlehem. And then we find out later that he dies while the Holy Family is in Egypt. And it's news of Herod's death, along with the angel, that prompts Jesus' return back to Israel, and Jesus stays in Galilee. Herod tries to make up his own story, and it's a story with Herod on the throne of his own life, and it's a lousy story that doesn't end at all well for Herod. So you have the story of the Magi. You have the story of Herod. There's a third story in this passage by application. And it is your story in Christ by God's grace. It's my story in Christ by God's grace. You know, the Israelite people, they had a people with a history and certain characteristics. We have a people in our modern 21st century time. We're postmodern people. We're in a digital age. We're in a therapeutic age. And Francis Schaeffer, who was the father of the modern worldview movement, he describes 21st century people. He died in 1980, but he was looking forward to our time. And he said, the problem with modern man is that he lives life in bits and pieces rather than in one coherent whole story. I'm quoting from memory. I think I'm almost right. But that's something to the effect of what Francis Schaeffer said. Life in bits and pieces rather than one coherent story. So most people today make up their own story. A few beers here, a little football here, some Netflix, a whole bunch of Facebook, whatever works, whatever feels right in the moment, if it all falls apart, we'll get some therapy and kind of get back on our feet again. And it's okay to be a wreck. And we are as modern people because we live life in bits and pieces without a coherent picture, a big picture of redemption and to tie us together. There's two rules in modern thought. One rule is don't think about mortality or death. Don't do this. Whatever, that's one of the reasons the virus scares us so much. Don't think about the end of life. Don't prepare for it. Just live in the moment. The other rule is don't listen to any story that takes you off the throne of your own life. Two rules for modern life. And so we have to look at this story and ask ourselves, who are we like here? Are we like the Magi who want more? Or are we like Herod who are making up the story of our own lives and trying to stay on the throne of our own lives? The Magi wanted more, and that desire allowed them to enter into the bigger story of redemption with Jesus at the center of it. Jesus, who took on flesh, who grew up and lived the perfect life before God. He took our sin on himself, paying the penalty for our sin, and he threw off death and rose from the dead, and he's coming back for those who are part of his story. You know, the reason why Matthew puts this account, it's an interesting account with the Magi. Nowhere else do we get it, but the reason why Matthew puts it in the Bible is that Jesus is the king of Israel, but the king of Israel is the king of the whole earth. And God wants unclean shepherds and pagan astrologers, he wants astronomers too, and scatterbrained, self-centered, postmodern people to trust him by faith and be folded into his big story of redemption, which is far bigger and bolder and more beautiful than any story that we could try to create on our own. You know, we enter God's big story by faith in Christ. The Magi, they didn't know what they needed to know yet in order to trust Jesus when they responded to God's revelation. But they responded to the pull of God as he revealed himself. They went and they asked the right questions and they turned up and they found Jesus and they worshiped him. That's the same thing we do. When we read about Jesus in the scriptures and then maybe alone or with others, it doesn't matter. We say, Lord, I believe in who you said that you are. You came, you were born, you grew up, you died, you took our sins on yourself, and I trust you and I want you. That's how we enter into the big story, by faith. We do that as individuals, but then we move out together as a group of people, and that's what we're going to be doing in the new year. We are joining our little stories to God's big story, which becomes our community story, which is part of what God is doing in the world. And that story is going to take us all the way until Jesus returns. And it's going to keep us unified. And it begins by wanting more, just like the Magi did. I think that's why they're there, to remind us most of all about Jesus, but also how we respond to him. Two short passages, and then we're done. Ephesians 2, 11 and 13. When you start thinking about God's big story, you find it all throughout the Bible. We find it here in Ephesians 2. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision, by what is called the circumcision, so you have these two peoples, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. We were all kind of like the Magi, coming from outside, the chosen people of God. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. We've entered in to this beautiful story of redemption by faith. And then 2 Corinthians 5:14 to 15. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all. See, Jesus is at the center of this. Therefore, all have died, and he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves. Don't have to make up our own stories. But for him who for their sake died and was raised. Our stories are now included in God's story. Jesus is our hope because he includes us in his story. And I don't know about you, but in this time of year when we think about great stories, and we sit at home, we read stuff, I like to think about the greatest story of all. And that gives me enormous hope because Jesus is at the center of this. I don't have to write this story. Jesus is at the center of it, and all I need to do is follow him by faith. And it's wonderful. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for being at the center of human history, at the center of creation. Thank you for making us and then buying us back from sin and death. Thank you for drawing us. And Lord Jesus, we want more of you all the time. And for those of us, most if not all of us, I pray, I hope, who have trusted in you by faith, you are at the center. We don't have to be afraid anymore. We don't have to live life in bits and pieces. We don't have to try to stay on the throne by intrigue or power or manipulation, because you are on the throne and we get to follow you and rest in you. And that hope carries us through the Christmas season. It carries us into the new year. It carries us all through the year and into the rest of our lives. Help us, Lord Jesus, to remember these three stories and then to remember that you fold us into your big story. Thank you for it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Brian. Isn't that awesome that we get to be a part of God's story? At this point in history is where God has placed us, 2020, almost 2021. And our lives are part of that. It is super awesome to just put things in proper perspective. So thank you, Brian. Let's stand together as we finish our worship service with this final song.
Groans for a world of darkness, grows
at 10:30, we do have a class for adults, and everybody else can enjoy their families this afternoon. And Lord bless and keep you this week, and we will see you in the new year, and it's going to be a good one serving the Lord together. Amen. See you soon.